this evening at 25 past midnight in retrial by TV. But first, some strong language as we examine the reliability of the victim as the only eyewitness to a crime.
If you were to witness a murder, how much would you remember?
I don't know who stabbed him, if anyone.
If your friend was abducted by an armed robber, would you be able to give the police a description of the kidnapper?
I certainly don't remember his facial features.
And what if you were the only witness to a crime where you were also the victim?
The kidnapper of the estate agent Stephanie Slater.
How accurate would your recollection be then?
I could explain noises. As for visual, nothing at all.
I'm here to tell you that eyewitnesses can make mistakes. And I'm sorry.
In our series so far, we've created 10 genuine eyewitnesses by exposing volunteers to realistic staged crimes they didn't expect to see. When they were on a lunch break, they witnessed a fatal stabbing. Just hours later, when interviewed by the police, they discovered that their memories of the crime were not as reliable as they thought.
This person was actually actively using a knife. He went down with that person and then shortly after I stabbed him and he ran.
Although the witnesses wanted to be as accurate as possible, their memories often let them down.
Did you ever see a knife?
No. Did not see a knife.
All memories fragmentary, all memories time compressed, all memory contains forgotten passages and amnesic parts. The big problem in using human memory in these witness settings is that memory often is simultaneously correct and incorrect.
Despite having already witnessed one crime, our volunteers' memories were no more reliable the second time around, when they found themselves in the midst of an armed robbery.
Give me the box! Give me the box!
Faced with guns, violence, and an abduction, they discover that the process of eyewitness identification, a mainstay of the criminal justice system, is also fraught with problems. As some of them wrongly identified two innocent men.
Was a person shown on the film?
Yes.
What number?
Two.
However, in both dramatized crimes, through a combination of careful questioning and cross-referencing of all 10 witness statements, the police were able to discover what actually happened and who was responsible.
It appears that the guy without the high-vis jacket is doing a punching motion three or four times to the victim whilst he's on the floor.
The corroborative evidence that they had gathered solely from the eyewitnesses meant they were confident about pursuing prosecutions in both our staged crimes.
I think it's given us a confidence to say we're doing the right thing and we're getting the right result.
Collectively, it'd certainly be enough to put in front of the courts and let the courts decide.
Well, you've got multiple witnesses to a serious crime. You're going to get to the facts eventually. But where you've got a victim who is also the only witness to the serious crime, that can be really difficult.
In 1992, one such case would prove to be a catalyst for changing the way British police forces approached eyewitness testimony. At the time, Stephanie Slater was 25 and worked as an estate agent in Birmingham.
I was a normal girl, had a boyfriend, had a large circle of friends, and I was happy. I was really happy.
Early on January 22nd, Stephanie went to her first appointment of the day.
was a cold January morning, and you just kind of want to get back to the office and a nice cup of tea or something. So I wasn't really with it. It was my first appointment of the day. I saw Bob Southall, the name he'd given, and he just looked like an average man. And we went into the house, he looked around the downstairs, he mumbled a few things to himself, he had a property guide on him, and I could see that he wasn't that interested in the house, so I said, do you want to see upstairs? So up we went. And he said, what's that up there? And he pointed into the bathroom. And on the wall was a hook, just a hook. And I even said, what this? You know, this is just for a flannel or a towel to be hung on. And then there was just silence. All of a sudden, his hands went under his coat. In his right hand was a long knife and his left was like a long chisel or file with a hook on the end of it. And he just came at me with these weapons.
After a struggle, Stephanie was overpowered.
He went for my neck and I sort of winced back, but he wanted my silk scarf. And he ripped that off, he ripped it in half with his knife, and he tied half around my eyes and half around my mouth. My own scarf became my gag and my blindfold. I didn't see anything after that moment, and that was for 8 days.
Having driven all day, they finally arrived at their destination. Stephanie was told that no one would hear her scream, and her kidnapper left her alone.
And for the first time, I'm on my own. And it's freezing cold. I'm shivering. I'm terrified. And I'm just sitting there thinking, dear God, where have you brought me?
The kidnapper was demanding a ransom from Stephanie's employers. And to ensure that she could never identify him, she was chained up, blindfolded, and locked inside a homemade wooden box, hidden inside a wheelie bin. Stephanie had given up all hope of ever seeing her family again. But then suddenly, she was set free.
Stephanie Slater was released after a ransom of £175,000 was delivered to the kidnapper by her boss. Stephanie described her ordeal as sheer terror.
When Stephanie was returned, I will admit to being extremely surprised, only because her kidnapper had returned the main and only witness that could find him.
The kidnapper of the estate agent Stephanie Slater is one of Britain's most dangerous men, according to the policemen leading the hunt.
The police urgently needed to know as much as possible from Stephanie about her kidnapper. But for most of her ordeal, she was cold, frightened, and kept in a terrifying world with no light. Not surprisingly, she was completely traumatized. Hostage negotiator DI Ellie Baker coordinated Stephanie's interviews.
It must have been so terrifying for her, and I felt really very, very sad listening to her tale. I've never sat with anyone and heard such trauma that a person's gone through for such a long period of time.
Despite being the victim of a heinous crime, Stephanie was also the only witness. She'd only seen her attacker briefly before she was kidnapped the previous week. Getting a description now would involve taking her back psychologically to the scene of the crime and reliving her terrible ordeal. The police decided to try what was then an experimental technique called cognitive interviewing.
Everything she told us was going to be an important factor. We needed descriptions of where she'd been, time spent in various locations, if she was blindfolded, what she could hear, what she could smell, and cognitive interviewing seemed to fit into that criteria.
Forensic psychologist Becky Milne teaches the cognitive approach to police officers throughout the UK.
I've got to try and provide an environment to enable people to say, I don't know.
The cognitive interview is a technique based on what we as psychologists know how memory works, and it's a collection of techniques to basically help enhance the quantity and quality of information from witnesses, victims of crime.
One of the most powerful aspects of the cognitive interview is contextual reinstatement, where witnesses are encouraged to immerse themselves in the minute details of their experience.
First of all, I'm going to ask you to close your eyes. Think about all the sounds you remember hearing this morning.
Contextual reinstatement has, on occasions, been referred to as a form of hypnotism. The academics, the specialists tell us that it's not. But it is a very focused state of mind that you place that witness in to recover the to-be-remembered event. And it's a great mechanism for accessing good, accurate testimony from that person.
Stephanie had actually seen very little of her ordeal, so her contextual reinstatement would have to rely on other sensory recollections.
I could explain smells and noises and even touching things, but as for visual, nothing at all.
Remembering the sounds and smells around her led Stephanie to believe that she was being held in some sort of workshop.
When I was in the box in the daytime and he opened his workshop to the public, I could hear him laughing and joking with people. And I could hear noises of a till, an old-fashioned cash till register. He had like a 70s telephone, which would ring, the old-fashioned ring. The microwave, I heard it ping. And I could hear trains in the distance, especially at night, when everything was quiet.
Also, he used a bucket for a toilet, and she was taking so many feet to get to that bucket. And when she got to the bucket, she could actually feel things on the wall. And so Stephanie actually began to build in her mind, which we actually listed the information, the format of the room.
The Stephanie Slater case was a landmark application of the cognitive interview in law enforcement in this country, because effectively what they did, they isolated the senses, and the senses that we possess are incredibly strong receptors of information.
A few days into the interview, Stephanie revealed a remarkable recollection.
I asked him for a very strange thing.
People in trauma do extraordinary things, and that they are fighting for their lives, so they would do anything to save their life.
I just said, "Bob, can I give you a hug?"
Stephanie was doing everything that was natural to her, and that was to behave herself and to actually try and get a rapport going with him.
Remembering that hug triggered an avalanche of crucial information about the kidnapper.
He had a smell, not BO, like a greasy, oily workman-type smell. He was a couple of inches taller than me. He was thick-set, stocky. He was clean-shaven and hairs on the backs of his hands. And I hadn't, at that time, thought, I must remember everything about this. And it turns out that he was exactly like that.
All Stephanie's descriptions were used to create an artist's impression of her kidnapper. The police went public to see if anyone recognised him.
Good evening. Tonight, once again, we're asking for your help to clear up some of this country's serious crimes.
In a few minutes, you'll hear the voice of the man who kidnapped Stephanie Slater.
Hi.
Have you got the money?
Who's this, please?
Never mind. Have you got the money? For tomorrow?
For tomorrow?
Yeah. Have you got it?
I'm getting it, yeah.
3 o'clock. You'll get a message at 3 o'clock.
A message at 3 o'clock tomorrow?
Yeah, at 3 o'clock tomorrow.
Crime Watch received over 5,000 calls about the crime, supplying the police with several leads. During the subsequent police investigation, officers visited one of the potential suspects at his place of work. What they discovered was a location that matched almost every single detail that Stephanie had described.
It was exactly how we imagined it. Everything she told us tended to be true. We had a toilet, a door. There it was in real life where Stephanie had been kept. And the smell of a hardware shop. You could actually see the railway line with the train going across.
The detectives knew immediately they had their man.
The police officers who had been and arrested him all came to congratulate the interview team, which was very nice, to say they'd never seen anything like it in their lives.
51-year-old Michael Sams was arrested and immediately confessed to kidnapping Stephanie and was charged with the murder of another young woman. Stephanie's contextual reinstatement was fundamental in both finding Sams and securing his conviction.
Michael Sams stood expressionless in the dock.
Passing sentence, Mr. Justice Judge told Sams that he was an extremely dangerous and evil man.
The Stephanie Slater case showed the power of the cognitive interview, which is now seen as the gold standard technique when interviewing witnesses and victims of serious crimes. In previous episodes of Eyewitness, we've seen that these techniques have been extremely effective in helping the police piece together our staged crimes. But we have also discovered that witnesses can remember things that didn't happen.
The guy in the high-vis jacket was just standing over this other guy kicking him.
You man, knock him out!
Forget things that did.
Sunglasses. Yeah, he had sunglasses on. Like a silver rim, thin silver rim.
And are very bad indeed at remembering faces.
Recognise number 4.
Number 10 looks familiar, but I don't know why.
I think number 7 was the chap who was just jumping about.
It's very difficult to say.
But it's not just accounts of crime that offer insight into memory fallibility. Claire, a nurse and mother, used to be, like everybody else, averagely bad at remembering details and faces. Then in 2004, a brain infection drastically affected her ability to remember almost anything.
I have a large part of my life which I've just lost from the age of sort of 18, 20 to up to my illness in my mid-40s. A life when, you know, I met my husband, I've had my children and, you know, a busy working life. And I've lost all the memory of that time completely.
The brain damage caused by Claire's encephalitis means she also has a real problem recognising faces.
I don't know my family. I don't know my friends. I don't know my mum, my dad, my sisters, you know. And it's very difficult to live with.
Claire's condition is an extreme example of the eyewitness problem. But a remarkable technology that she is using could help us all with memory recall. Professor Martin Conway is a world authority on memory. He's been studying Claire for the past 18 months and has discovered that under certain circumstances, she can remember.
How are you? Good to see you. Thanks. Thanks to you.
Press the left button. I remembered that, you see.
Very good.
There we go.
Claire is viewing photographs from a device called a sense cam, which she wears around her neck.
Here I am arriving at the house, unlocking the door. Do you want me to talk?
The sense cam records an image whenever one of its senses are triggered by changes in light, temperature, or motion.
Getting some water ready for the flowers.
Today, Claire is watching sense cam images from when her in-laws moved house 9 months ago.
Somewhere.
The theory is, because SenseCam takes pictures in an automated fragmentary way, and because the records are visual, and from the user's perspective, the images mirror and trigger our own personal memories in a way that ordinary photographs cannot. And if Claire's experience is anything to go by...
And now that is Judy. I'm not 100% sure, but I think it's Judy.
It looks like the theory might be right.
Oh, I know, I remember now exactly what I did first, and that was get the flower. I'd taken a bunch of flowers so that when they arrived, they had a nice bunch of flowers in their new house.
It's helped me see the whole thing again, feel like I'm doing it and part of it.
There they are.
The images Claire looks at could be having a profound effect on her damaged brain. There are signs that using the sense cam is helping to retrieve Claire's lost memories.
And I was walking towards the bus station, so there wasn't a set meeting place. I didn't know what Faye was wearing or anything. And I recognised her. It took my whole breath away. There she was. I knew it was her, and it was just the most incredible feeling. My sister, Faye. Oh.
If SenseCam can retrieve memories from those with neurological damage, can it help with the problem of eyewitness recollections? In a world first, Professor Conway will be investigating what effect, if any, the technology will have on our witnesses' recall of the first crime they saw. When they witnessed the pub fight, two of our volunteers, Chrissy and Graham, were wearing SenseCams. As they experienced every aspect of being at the pub, the sense cam was also taking snapshots from their point of view. Now a month later, they've travelled to the York Neuroimaging Centre, where Professor Martin Conway will show them their sense cam images to see if they stimulate their recall of the crime.
All taken by my
by your sense,
by my sense cam.
It's very exciting indeed. This is the first time that anyone's ever sense cammed a crime and then done a neuroimaging study of it. So it's a one-off.
Having seen their sense cam images, will Chrissy and Graham now remember the event in more detail?
I guess. I just remember it was really weird that the policeman was saying, what was the food like?
An MRI scan will reveal the level of brain activity.
What we're hoping to find is that the patterns of activation for the pub event are much more intense and much more extensive towards the back of the brain, where we believe visual episodic memories are stored.
Nice and still. Here we go.
As a control, Martin first established how our volunteers' brains normally behave when accessing memories. They were first asked to remember emotional moments from their lives.
So she's calling a moment when she was happy.
Okay, this next task will be negative events.
Then they were asked to recall specific moments on that fateful day.
She's now been asked to remember travelling on the bus to the pub. Remembering being the people in the bar having a row, and she's recalling a memory of that.
Chris's brain scan revealed extraordinary results. When Chrissy recalls memories, the active parts of her brain show up in red and yellow. The more colour means the more vivid are her memories, like in this image, where she has been asked to remember negative events in her life. But when compared with Chris's recollection of the pub event, the big concentrated areas of red and yellow shows that SenseCam is helping her remember events in much more vivid detail.
This is much clearer for the event that she's made a SenseCam of than for any of the other tasks she's done so far, which is what we hoped would happen. And it's certainly happening with her, isn't it?
Graham's brain activity exceeded all Martin's expectations.
Well, look at this. Huge areas of activation in the posterior part of the brain. Probably what's happening with Graham at the moment is he's having intensely vivid and detailed memories of small scenes to do with the pub experience. And that's reflected in these huge patterns of activation here. These are the sorts of activations you might see if you're actually visually looking at something.
If I hadn't seen those pictures, I would have been doing just more of a sort of broad overview of it all, but I was sort of recalling little tiny details.
The MRI shows that triggering memories with SenseChem images had a profound effect on how vividly details of the crime were remembered. Originally developed as a personal black box, its future use could not only aid those with memory loss, but according to Professor Conway, could help witnesses with contextual reinstatement in criminal investigations.
The future, really, of witnesses generally is going to involve things like this. Visual records they might have made at the time, even though they didn't know they were going to witness a crime, followed later by brain scans which establish, to some extent, the truth of what they're saying.
Today, contextual reinstatement, part of the cognitive interview, is an essential part of helping witnesses and victims of crime.
Tell me everything you can remember.
Everything that you saw.
And there's some shouting.
Ten of us. It's all quite quick. It didn't go on for very long, the whole thing.
Was a car travelling at great speed reversing.
And we came across a robbery. There was a security van parked.
Did they all have guns? I think two of them definitely had guns.
But as powerful as it is, it must also be backed up by structured police questioning.
At some point, questions are going to have to be asked, and this is the next sort of phase of the interview.
So the lower half of the body, what was he wearing?
Where did that noise come from?
Now, the best type of questions are what we call the open question. The open question is all about getting more free recall. They open up an interviewee's response.
How much of him could you see?
How would you describe his body language?
Tell me more about the guy with the gun, as long as obviously they've mentioned a guy with a gun. They also are trained to use more closed questions to probe and prompt more specific detail.
For sitting down to actually finishing that meal, how long was that?
And how long did he seem to be in that position for?
Starts to move towards the bar. What does he do then?
What in the pub is near to that table that you can recall?
Gathering evidence from an eyewitness is laden with possibilities for contamination, from initial conversations to suspect identification.
Quite defined, sort of, I don't know what that muscle is.
Got to be your words on the statement, so which part of the leg are you referring to there?
Well, sort of the outside of the thigh, I guess.
Anything that is said to an eyewitness by a police officer can affect their recall in an interview and can have dire consequences for justice. As one woman in North Carolina would discover. In 1984, Jennifer Thompson was at college, studying for a degree in sports management.
I was 21. I was going to class full time and was making straight A's, so that was very exciting. I was dating a student at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and he was in graduate school. So we were talking about getting married, and we were very serious.
But in the early hours of July 29th, Jennifer's life was changed forever.
Around 3 o'clock in the morning, I thought I heard something in the bedroom. Then something brushed my left arm. And I was on my back, and when I looked over the side of my bed, I saw someone's head kind of scooting beside my mattress. And so I, of course, screamed. I said, "Who is that? Who's there?" And this person jumped on my bed and quickly put a gloved hand across my mouth and straddled my body and put a knife to my throat and told me to shut up or he was going to kill me. I mean, it was absolutely beyond terrifying and horrible. I mean, I really thought I was going to die. I honestly believed that this is how my parents were going to find me, that this was the last image I was ever going to see, was someone raping me.
In the midst of the devastating assault, Jennifer made a conscious decision. She was determined to be such a good eyewitness that she would be instrumental in securing her attacker's conviction.
I decided that And if I live through this, I wanted to know the shape of his eyes. I wanted to know the color of his hair. I wanted to know, you know, the shape of his face, how old he was, how much he weighed, what his voice sounded like. Did he have any tattoos? Did he have a scar? Something and everything that I could remember that I could bring to the police and hopefully catch this person and put him away for life. I was able to somehow keep some part of control in my mind that I thought, you know, I'm gonna live through this, and when I live through this, you're going to prison, and you're never, ever, ever gonna walk on this earth a free man, and you'll never do this to another woman if I have anything to do with it.
After the rape, the attacker fled. Jennifer was taken to hospital by the police, where Detective Mike Goulding was the first officer to interview her.
Although she was emotional and upset, as you would expect any rape victim to be, she had a presence of mind and a sense of determination that I hadn't seen before in a rape victim. She quickly informed me that she got a very good look at her assailant.
Detective Goulding worked with Jennifer to create an identikit image that would be circulated in the hope that somebody might recognize it.
We began to work through this identikit where you have a selection of eyes and a selection of eyebrows and a selection of eyelashes, mouths and lips and cheeks and chins and noses and nostrils and ears and everything. And so you start putting together these pieces of the face that you remember seeing hours ago. When we were done, they asked me if this looked like the person who raped you, and the answer to that was yes, it did.
The police needed to act fast, because after raping Jennifer, her assailant went on to attack a second woman.
This was a pretty urgent situation for us. Jennifer had been raped. There was another lady raped less than a mile and a half from here, within an hour and a half of the time that Jennifer was raped. The police had actually chased the suspect not only from this scene, but from her scene. He was a very brazen suspect. Committed two rapes, and he was out in the community running at large. We were very fearful for the community. We knew he was armed, and it was a desperate situation to try to apprehend him.
Within a few days of the public appeal, a number of suspects had been suggested. Their pictures were shown to Jennifer as a photo lineup.
I immediately discounted four. And then you start doing that's not his ears, and those ears look closer, and that's not his nose, and that nose really looks like his nose, and his hair's too long.
Jennifer had picked out a man called Ronald Cotton. Later, the police called Jennifer back to identify the suspect in a live lineup.
I remember walking into the room, and there was nothing between me and this physical lineup but a table, like a picnic table type of thing. It was a folding table. That was it. No windows, no glass. And I saw these seven men come in, and I just was terrified. I thought, oh my God, there's nothing to protect me. And if I don't get this right, he's walking and he's seen me. And I just remember being just sick, like nauseous. My knees were shaking, I was sweating, my heart was racing. I remember looking at number four and number five and going, And then I wrote down number five. And I handed it to the detective.
Number five, the man Jennifer chose, was again the suspect, Ronald Cotton. And based on her strong eyewitness identification, the case went to court. Despite protesting his innocence, at the trial in January 1985, Cotton was convicted of rape and sentenced to life plus 50 years in prison.
We went back to the district attorney's office, and it was little paper cups, had champagne. You know, toasted the judicial system working like it was supposed to work.
Justice was served. I felt satisfied that we had gotten the right person and that it was over, you know. Everybody could move forward. Jennifer with her life, we could move on to the next case, and that was that.
But it wasn't for Ronald Cotton. A year into his sentence, a convicted serial rapist named Bobby Poole was sent to the same prison. The two men looked so alike that the guards often got them confused. Cotton discovered that Poole had bragged to fellow inmates it was he who had raped Jennifer. Ronald Cotton decided to appeal his sentence, accusing Bobby Poole of Jennifer's rape. At the appeal, Jennifer came face to face with Poole.
I remember looking at him and thinking, you know, I don't know who he is. I've never seen him before in my life. Like, it didn't, nothing hit me. It was just a bad guy that was in prison.
Not only did Jennifer fail to identify Bobby Poole, but the second victim who had been raped the same night and who had previously identified someone else now came forward to claim Ronald Cotton was also her attacker. Cotton was now convicted of both rapes, and this time given two life sentences. Jennifer finally felt she could get on with her life.
In the spring of 1990, in April, I gave birth to triplets, two girls and a boy. It was wonderful. I spent all my time taking care of these children, and I loved every second of it. It was great until spring of 1995.
In North Carolina, at the time of Cotton's trial, the practice of analyzing DNA evidence was not routine. But 10 years later, it had become more commonplace. Cotton, still maintaining his innocence, asked for DNA evidence to be analyzed. The DNA did not belong to Ronald Cotton. It belonged to Bobby Poole.
I was really devastated. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe that Ronald was, first of all, innocent, which he was, but yet that I had been involved in a case that, sent a man to prison that didn't deserve to go.
10 years after being wrongly convicted, Ronald Cotton was finally released.
A long time you are walking out here today as a free man.
I can't tell you how many times I looked at that case and rethought it and, you know, tried to envision what I could have done differently that would have prevented it. And so it was very bad.
I told you God I was going to do it then. Didn't I? You're going to make it.
And I just felt so, so sad and so awful. I knew that it had been my identification. I mean, I knew that. It wasn't malicious intent, it wasn't racially motivated, but it didn't matter, because the end result was Ronald Cotton spent a third of his life in prison for something he didn't do. And Bobby Poole had been left on the streets for all that time and had been victimizing and raping other women.
What Jennifer didn't know was that by the time she picked Ronald Cotton out of the lineup, her memory was so contaminated that even had Bobby Poole been there, she would still have identified Cotton.
I always liken memory to snow. You've woken up in the morning and it has snowed and there's a field of white, virginal snow. No one has contaminated yet. No one has walked on that snow. But as soon as you start walking on snow, the snow goes brown. And the more you walk on it, the mushier it gets. And it's the same with human memory. Human memory, basically, can be so easily contaminated by people walking all over it. Now, unfortunately, it's very difficult to get brown snow white again. And it's the same with human memory. It's absolutely impossible to get human memory back to the original if it has already been contaminated.
Since Ronald's release, Jennifer has devoted her life to highlighting the problems of inaccurate eyewitness identification.
Thank you. If there's this much doubt in any of your hearts and in any of your souls, if you think there's this...
Through her campaigning, she's now acutely aware of why she so convincingly identified the wrong man. Jennifer believes that the contamination started as soon as she was asked to create an identikit image.
When you do an identikit or a composite sketch, what you do is you come up with a likeness of the person that you remember seeing. And a likeness at best. Some of them are clearly not even close to a likeness.
When Jennifer viewed the photo lineup, she was looking for someone who resembled her identikit image, not her memory of the attacker. And despite being told that her attacker may or may not be in the lineup, she felt sure he was.
You're not called in to do a photo lineup or a physical lineup if they don't have a suspect. There's someone there that they suspect is the person. It's my job to figure it out and to find them.
As the real rapist wasn't even in the lineup, subconsciously, Jennifer chose the photograph that she now felt looked most like the man who raped her. Then, a seemingly casual comment from an officer in the room reinforced her choice of suspect.
Well, they ask you, you know, your degree of certainty, you know, how sure are you, I'm positive. And then they told me that we thought that was him.
The detective who actually did the background work on Ronald Cotton was present, and he made a comment that he felt like Ronald was the one who raped her. And I understand why he said it, but unfortunately, I know now it's something that shouldn't have taken place.
But what happened next, more than anything else, sealed Ronald Cotton's fate. Jennifer was asked to identify her attacker again in a live lineup. She picked out Ronald Cotton, the man she already identified from the photograph and who was clearly in her memory, the man the police had indicated they thought was guilty.
The time I picked Ronald Cotton out of a physical lineup and I go to trial, Ronald Cotton is now the attacker because you've got this compilation of visuals that have now become kind of enmeshed and squashed into this one memory.
You got the identikit, the photograph, and the lineup. It's a classic case of unconscious transference. It's a recipe for disaster. She was always going to pick the man in the lineup because she recognized him from the photograph. Doesn't mean that he's the rapist, but she's going to pick him because it's somebody that she recognizes.
And it wasn't only Jennifer's memory that was contaminated by unconscious transference. Once branded as the rapist, Ronald Cotton's face had replaced that of the true rapist in the second victim's mind. The Cotton case has helped ensure that in the state of North Carolina, police officers can no longer influence witnesses, and lineups must be presented sequentially.
We've made reform in this state through legislation that mandates what we believe to be as a better practice that hopefully will prevent wrongful convictions in the future. So, I guess you could say something good has come from the Ronald Cotton case. It's just unfortunate that, you know, it happened like it did, and he lost all those years of his life.
Two years after his release, Ronald and Jennifer met for the first time.
He and I sat and just really shared what had happened to the two of us, you know, as victims, really, of a flawed system that oftentimes doesn't work, but also as victims of Bobby Poole, a man who would have been very content to have died in prison and let Ronald rot. it wouldn't have bothered him at all.
Today, the British police have strict safeguards to prevent miscarriages of justice like the Cotton case.
My name's Carol Barlow. I'm a detective sergeant here in Manchester. And you've met Wendy Haslam, who's the other police officer who's next door.
Yep.
A better understanding of memory has informed the police process, from interviewing to suspect identification, and has been integrated into modern law enforcement.
The UK police are the envy of the world. The whole process of interviewing witnesses and victims is transformed beyond belief. We have officers and representatives from law enforcement agencies from all over the world that come to the UK for training, and it's something that I think we can be rightly proud of.
The Greater Manchester Police were one of the early adopters of many of the systems put in place to ensure witness evidence is collected safely. They use specialist interviewers and routinely record everything on video and audio so there could be no ambiguity later. In 2007, they were faced with an investigation that would put their training and techniques under the most intense scrutiny.
Get on, sir!
In a well-planned and clinically executed violent robbery, lasting only 7 minutes, over £1.5 million worth of Lowry paintings were stolen from the home of Louise Eyre. She was both the victim and the key eyewitness.
Went to open the door to the postman.
Get in.
He had a knife at my face and my daughter was in my arms. Then I started screaming over here in the corner, trying to shield Sabrina's face as much as I could. And he said, don't look at me, don't look at me, or I'll kill you, I'll kill you. The knife was waving around and he just had this face, you know, he didn't care what he was doing, who he was threatening to kill. And I thought, no, I will look at your face. And then they were just going in and out the rooms, taking the paintings.
The case would come to rely solely on eyewitness evidence, so the police had to do everything by the book. They had to treat Louise's memory with as much care as they would a physical crime scene.
Nowadays, it's very rare to see a conviction just on witness testimony. You normally have supportive forensic evidence, corroborative evidence from other witnesses, but on occasions, that evidence at court may well be challenged and may be lost. So it's imperative that what you have got from your witness will stand the strongest possible scrutiny in court.
Chris Barnes was one of the detectives assigned to Louise Eyre's case.
Considering the trauma Louise had gone through on that morning, she was very calm, gave us a lot of information, and it was at that stage that we decided that it should be interviewed on video by a specially trained officer.
This use of the cognitive interview allowed the police to collect and preserve Louise's memories while ensuring the whole process was transparent.
From hearing the doorbell ring, when you wherever you are in the house, just start from there and tell me everything you can remember
right.
To when you phoned the police.
Well, I heard the doorbell, so I got out of bed.
Louise was encouraged to relive her 7-minute ordeal and describe everything she remembered in extreme detail.
See what I thought was the postman, sort of the side of him. So I rushed to the door and Sabrina came with me. She didn't want to be on her own, so she was in my arms. The second I opened the door, I get shoved back. Then I remember looking at him again. And he said, don't look at me, I'll kill you.
Next, the interviewer used contextual reinstatement to take Louise back to the scene of the crime.
So you remember them where?
Yeah, they went in the hallway,
okay.
Rather than in the first entrance.
Okay. When you say day, how many are we talking about?
So we're talking three plus him with the knife.
Right.
It's hard for them, I think, to relive what's happened, but most police officers will put them at ease and tell them that this is the way we will catch the offenders.
I was fearing for my life. So I was really scared.
To safeguard against memory contamination, the interviewer only asked Louise open and carefully probing questions about her attacker.
What sort of height are we talking?
About 5'8".
So tell me about his face.
I don't remember his nose being, I think it was quite straight, but it might have, I remember it being a bit wide at the bottom.
It's totally exhausted me. I can't believe all what you've remembered and all the details and everything. The way they did it, it helps your memory, really. Makes you sit and think, and you're not under any pressure of hurrying up.
It was clear that she'd had a really good view, you know, for a number of minutes of this man. He'd not in any way tried to hide his face.
Clear skin, clean shaven, fair complexion.
It was decided, as opposed to showing photos or video ID at this stage, to get an e-fit to see if anybody in the public would know who this man was.
E-fit is a computerised replacement of the Identikit and PhotoFit systems. Based on the knowledge that we are better at recognising whole faces rather than individual features. A description of the suspect is fed into the computer, which comes up with an entire face. Unlike earlier systems where fixed features had to be placed together to make a composite. E-fit also allows the witness to manipulate the size and position of the facial features in relation to each other, resulting in a more accurate likeness. Just 72 hours after the crime took place, Louise had completed an e-fit of the man who threatened her during the robbery. To her surprise, the resulting image was an amazing likeness of the man who attacked her.
Get him!
I knew that the e-fit was like 99%. It was him.
After the e-fit was circulated, the police got several tip-offs that the robber might be a man known to them. A man with previous convictions for violent robbery, Casey Miller. But this could only be confirmed if Louise were to pick him out in an identity parade. As we know, live identity lineups are now considered flawed, as witnesses tend to make relative decisions and feel obliged to pick someone, whether they actually recognize them or not. So the lineup Louise viewed was electronic, like this one, where a picture of the suspect is placed with similar faces and shown to her sequentially.
At the time, Miller was on the run from the police. It was becoming harder and harder to find him. Louise looked at the ID parade, viewed it a second time and said, "It's number 5. And it was him. The interviewing officers who interviewed Miller were stunned when they sat in front of him and saw the e-fit.
I couldn't believe how I'd got it so right.
The case went to court. With inconclusive DNA evidence, Louise's eyewitness testimony that Casey Miller led the robbery at her house was crucial to the prosecution case.
Court process was a bit scary. His barrister was really at me, and I thought, oh, you're not getting me. I wanted to make sure that I convinced the jury because I knew it was 100% that it was him.
The jury was convinced, and Miller was sent to jail.
The cognitive interview was crucial in this case. We had no forensics, no CCTV, and the only eyewitness we had was Louise. So the interview got out of her testimony, which then led to the e-fit, which in the end led to the conviction.
It is absolutely essential that when a conviction is secured, it is a safe conviction, underpinned by good testimony from witnesses who've been processed in a proper way.
Over the course of our eyewitness series, we've gained an understanding of how our memories work.
No, I'm trying to remember it.
It's a very colourful picture. We'd like you to make it look as much like you remember it. And you've been given a set of black, yellow...
We recruited 10 volunteers who thought they were only taking part in a documentary about memory and turned them into key and significant eyewitnesses. During two elaborately staged violent crimes, we secretly recorded and captured every piece of action. So that we could compare what our witnesses remembered seeing with what actually happened. And we've seen through their eyes just how fallible memory can be.
Sunglasses. Yeah, he had sunglasses on.
We've discovered that we can be all too easily mistaken.
The guy in the high-vis jacket was just standing over this other guy kicking him.
Knock him out!
If it's the female, it was the second one. We put the security man on the floor. I'm not 100% for that.
And we've shown the perils of eyewitness identification.
I recognise number 4.
Number 10 looks familiar.
I think number 7 was the chap who was just jumping about.
It's very difficult to say.
Number 2.
I'm pretty sure number 2.
There have been tears. Laughter.
I'm trying not to look there.
Oh, I'm just looking all over.
An utter disbelief.
Fortunately, the lad who was attacked here has died at hospital. But just to let you know how serious this is, all right? So we're taking it very seriously.
I mean, it's a bit of a cheat that I put in there, but I've never had hair like that. Never in my life.
Do you want the registration number?
Yes, please.
November Golf, 58, and then it was Victor X-ray Whiskey.
As we have seen, there is no such thing as a perfect memory. But with modern police techniques based on science, witness testimony is today more reliable than ever before. So how did our volunteers find this unique experience?
And I found that I've been, you know, I've got quite a good memory for some things and absolutely atrocious for other things, so it's been a really, really good experience.
Being honest, I didn't realise it was a setup until the very end.
I don't think I've ever had to sort of analyse or think back about something in so much detail before.
I actually feel quite privileged to have been asked to contribute, and I've learnt an awful lot about myself.
And I think it was fantastic, really, the thoroughness.
It's hard to tell what is actually my memory and what is actually my mind filling in gaps.
It certainly has opened my mind up to be more vigilant and to be more observant.
Perhaps if I did see something in real life, I would probably make notes on it immediately just to make sure that I don't forget it by the time the police actually ask me.
We could not exist if it wasn't for witnesses. They're the lifeblood of investigators. They're so important to everything we do that we need them. Without them, we're nothing.
Witnesses can get details wrong, but could they ever remember an event that never happened? To find out, go to bbc.co.uk/eyewitness.
Next this evening, Time Shift looks back over TV's reaction to the miscarriage of justice in Retrial by TV, the rise and fall of Rough Justice. Time Shift charts the history of capital punishment here.